Mr. President, we have a national emergency.
This is one of the things that we can shoot first and ask questions later. Normally you can't do that.
All of a sudden these trees started moving out of the way. They parted for me. And then I came out into this opening, and there where I saw Jesus Christ.
Back in 1927, an American socialist, Norman Thomas, 6 times candidate for president on the Socialist Party ticket, said the American people would never vote for socialism. But he said under the name of liberalism, the American people will adopt every fragment of the socialist program. Is more imminent.
James Madison, in 1788, speaking to the Virginia Convention, said, "Since the general civilization of mankind, I believe there are more instances of the abridgment of the freedom of the people by gradual and silent encroachment of those in power than by violent and sudden usurpations."
When men were free.
End Time Prophecy News with your host, W. Dean Shook, is on the air.
My friends, thank you everybody for joining us. I appreciate it so much. This is going to be a conversation that I don't like to have, a conversation about apostasy in America, among Christians, among the Christian world. This is about people who claim to be Christian but have no idea what a true Christian believes, thinks, feels, or acts. We're going to start this discussion in just a minute. Don't go away.
Listening to W. Dean Shook, End Time Prophecy News and Current Events. Stay tuned.
Hello? Hey, what's going on, man? Not that things around here are getting so weird. Things are so weird.
Grok.
What was that? I don't know, but can't talk to the counselors at school. Can't talk to my parents. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know where I'm going to turn.
Grok.
What was that?
Need help?
Maybe support. Some prayer. Or just someone to talk to. The CYI Worldwide Network, home of the Grok Show. Place where you can just talk, and someone will listen. The Grok Show on the CYI Worldwide Network.
You can now hear our program on Stitcher Smart Radio. Stitcher allows you to listen to your favorite shows directly from your iPhone, Android phone, Kindle Fire, and more. It's on demand and on the go. Don't have Stitcher? Download it free today at Stitcher.com or in the App Store. Stitcher Smart Radio, the smarter way to listen to radio.
All right, I'm ready to start the program. You got some popcorn, you got your Bible open, are you ready to listen? How about participate? Apparently we're having some issues tonight with our phone line. So for that group of people who usually call in and just listen on their phone, who are not calling in to be on the program, keep trying. Hopefully you'll be able to get through. I see there's a few of you that got through, so some people are getting through, but the switchboard is not lit up like it usually is with people listening. So keep trying. I know we're having some known issues with the switchboard. There's not much I can do about it. So our subject tonight is, let me see this. It's sometimes disturbing and sad when you talk about the apostasy of Christians and the apostasy of this country, because you hate to see this kind of thing happen, and I hate to see people falling away from the faith, or should I even say falling away, if they were never there in the first place. But when it comes to our nation, America, it is a falling away. Us as a group, as a country, are falling away because we started on a biblical foundation. And I know that there's a lot of people who throw themselves down, kick their feet, and scream like a schoolgirl, "We are not, well, we weren't." And they're trying to change history. They're trying to rewrite history. They're trying to take God out of everything. They're trying to take it out of our founding documents, out of when the president talks about the Bill of Rights or anything like that, where it's the part where it says that we are endowed by our Creator, he leaves out the Creator part, because they're trying to weed God out of America, and there's a price to pay for that. You know, and it also says in Last Day Prophecy, End Time Prophecy, that there will be a great falling away first, you know. Paul spoke about this expressly, because there were people at the time who believed that that Christ's return was going to happen in the first century. And Paul made it clear that and we're going to cover this here in a little bit. He made it clear that, you know, do not be deceived, because first there must be a great falling away, and this Antichrist has to be made known, paraphrasing, of course. So I want to talk about, first of all, our country, our politicians, this whole movement to get God out of society. You know, it doesn't take a lot of thought, or it doesn't take a lot of intelligence even, to figure out that when a country is based not a theocracy, but it's based on Christian principles, where the idea of God and his wrath, his judgment, the way we're supposed to live, when this is all part of our country,
then the country has an overall sense of at least some level of morality and standards that they live by. I mean, it used to be that a man's handshake was his bond, and you didn't need these extensive contracts with all of this legal double talk to try to just do the simplest deals. But nowadays, that's not the case. Honesty and integrity are gone. They're gone at this point. And this has happened over a slow period of time. Because since the beginning of this nation, Christianity has been the main religion that people have claimed to be their own. They've claimed to be followers of Christ. They believed in his word, the Bible, as God's revelation to man. And in the past 100 years or so, this nation's been walking away from the true God of the Bible. And yet, 80% of the people in this country still claim to be Christian. Some say it's 82%. Whatever. You know, 80% of the people in this country still claim to be Christian. Well, what makes a person Christian? What defines what a Christian is? It's how they live, how they think, how they act. What fruit should we expect from a Christian nation of people following the Bible and Christ? What should we expect from 80% of the population of a country of 300 million people who claim biblical belief and the belief in the true God, Yahweh, Christ? The truth is, America is not only not a Christian nation, most people who speak God's or Christ's name are taking it in vain. That is, to no good, useful purpose. So, let's understand this. America and Americans who claim to be Christian have, within its population, supported everything that's non-Christian. Now, we should expect Christian actions and thoughts from Christian people. 80% of 300 million people claim to be Christian. But yet, the overwhelming majority of this country still support the killing of over 50 million of its unborn children through abortion. Child sacrifice. This was something that was practiced by pagan societies throughout history. This is not Christian. And yet people claim that in certain cases, abortion is okay. You know what? There is never a time that killing an innocent life is okay. And this has been a long-standing belief, not only for me, but in Christianity, that there is no reason to murder an unborn baby. That's still a human being. It's not a blob of goo. Now, it doesn't matter to the child how they were conceived. It's still a human life. So whether Uncle Jerry raped his niece, or, you know, it was father-daughter, you know, whatever this was, the child didn't have anything to do with that. It was not the child's choice. Yet the child pays the price. And they pay the price because the parents either don't want to deal with the feelings of having that child, very selfish, just incredibly selfish, or they don't want, you know, they say, I can't afford it, or this is, I already have three kids, or a single parent, all of these things. If they had been living the Christian life in the first place, they wouldn't be a single parent. I mean, all of these things are a snowball effect of a secular society, not a Christian nation that we're supposed to be. We also have in this country of 300 million, 80% claiming to be Christian, which is another reason why we have such a bad name. We have the highest crime rate of any nation on the planet, with more of its own population in prison, despite all of those unjustly imprisoned for no real crime having been committed at all. We still have more of its population in prison than any other nation on Earth. What about the manufacturing of pornographic materials? Illicit sex, sexual exploitation of children. Because I tell you what, the child sex trade is alive and well in America. Other sexual sins, homosexuality, are being readily accepted. Everybody says it's okay, that homosexuality is fine, it's accepted, it's normal, and it's healthy. I could do a whole program just on that and offend probably most everybody. But the truth is, this is a perversion. I mean, look, I'm going to say this, and this is going to offend some people. But have you ever seen a dog lick his own rectum? You know, a dog will also meet up with another dog and lick another dog's rectum. And people are grossed out by that. You see a dog doing that to another dog, and you go, hey, 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 knock that off. Oh, gee, you know, you just, oh, man, I can't believe you, do you see what your dog is doing? I mean, that's the reaction, you know? And it's a reaction that comes from nature. Even little kids who see that, they'll go, oh. But yet, the Christian, 80% of this country say that when a man wants to do that to another man, that we have to accept that as being normal and healthy. And there is no argument that can be made that's going to make that normal and healthy, because it's not. It not only goes against God and goes against nature, but it offends every aspect of everyone's life, just like the dogs do when virtually anybody sees a dog doing that. The whole idea of this whole thing is not normal or healthy. And there's no argument that can be made by anyone that's going to make me accept this as normal and healthy. And to let people with these perversions adopt children and raise them in a home where this is practiced, no, I'm not going to accept that under any circumstances. Now that I got that off my chest, let's get back to the subject at hand. I had to get that out there, though, because the sexual immorality in this country is out of control. Out of control. That is why we have so many broken families. That's why we have so many children that don't have mothers and or fathers in their family. That's why they're now calling marriages, first marriages in America of people under the age of 25, as a test marriage or a starter marriage. If they're getting married at all, they're saying now that it's like 60% of everybody under the age of 30, they're not even getting married. You have to treat your potential partner just like you do when you go buy a car. You don't buy a car unless you test drive it first. And that's what they're doing. And I'm not just talking about sex. These are people who are moving in together. They'll live together. This is a test to see if it's going to work out. Well, if they have the commitment, if they make the commitment, they have to stick to that commitment. And that's the problem today. People cannot stick to their own commitments. They say before a justice of the peace or a minister or wherever, however they get married, they make a vow to stay with that person till death do they part. When actually what it means is that this is a starter marriage, and it's only until they're tired of it or they feel like they can't go on or they're not in love with that person anymore, then they break the commitment that they've made and move on to somebody else. Now, think about that. When you go to marry somebody else who's divorced, ask them why they're divorced. Well, we just weren't in love anymore. Oh, so in other words, you can't stand up to hard times. When things get rough or when things get hard, that's when you quit. And is that the kind of person you want? Somebody who quits when it gets hard. When things get difficult, they say, no, I'm done with this. I don't want to deal with it. It's too difficult. They can't keep their commitment. Is that the kind of person you want? Somebody who's going to walk out on you when you probably need them most? This is the idea of the whole illicit sex and everything that comes with that. That's why you're told not to do this until after marriage. Because there's a process through the instruction manual, the Holy Bible. There's a process in the Holy Bible that allows you to have a successful marriage with a true commitment that lasts till the day you die. You're with that person till the day you die without being with other people. But yet today's society, walking away from God in America, this no longer exists. And people say, are you kidding me? Why would I ever do something like that? You know, if he ever does that, if he ever does that, I'm out of here. If she ever does this or that, then it's over. It's over. Because that's the attitude. It's from one partner to the other, to the other, to the other. Leadership is breaking down the laws of the land, violating our Constitution daily. These people are committing treason. And with a judicial branch of government, which is utterly corrupted, is passing the most judgment. This is a legislative branch of treasonous, greedy, lazy, selfish leaders, and treasonous executive branch that seeks a world empire at the cost of the worldwide lives of our national assets. Corporate greed, corruption, this whole environmental movement, the whole indoctrination of our young people, trying to teach everyone in our schools that we are not a Christian nation, we're an atheist nation. You can believe whatever you want. Set your own standards. Set your own morals. Be your own person. Is that what God set us out to be? Is that how we were set up to be? Is it some reason that, is it not obvious that when we walk away from the basic morality that we were built on, that these kind of things are happening? You know, the news media manipulation of information is corrupt. It's government control. This is greed. These are people that are turning a blind eye to the obvious fact that the man holding the office of president is not a native-born citizen. And he's ineligible to hold office. And he's deceived the whole world. Evidence is everywhere. He has spent millions of dollars hiding his records. Yet Americans fight to have this exposed, subverting the Constitution and the rule of law is what he's doing here, our president. Now, people say, well, I just don't believe that. All you have to do is look at the evidence. Why is he sealing up all of these records so that nobody can look into his records? His college records are sealed and can be viewed by no one. All of his records in Kenya and Indonesia have been sealed. The Hawaii records have been sealed. The birth certificate that he put out online as being the long form has proven to be fake. His attorneys admitted in court under oath that it cannot be that the birth certificate that he put online cannot be used as evidence because it was an obvious fake. Only an idiot would have believed it. Yet millions of Americans believe it. And they're allowing this corruption. Public school propaganda is utilized by groups with an agenda to brainwash our kids into being good government slaves. They're being taught basic 101 socialism. You know, I don't know what it's like where you live, but here in the state of Oregon, they've now got this program where they send, well, we've always had a program where you send the list of school supplies home, and the parents are supposed to supply these school supplies for your kids. This is what they're going to need. Well, you buy them these supplies, and then when they go to the school, the teacher takes it away from them and puts it all in a community barrel. A community basket, and says when somebody needs something, they'll just go pick what they need out of the community basket. So if little Johnny over here decides that his parents decided they're going to buy the cheap markers, and you decide you're going to buy your kid the top-of-the-line markers, your kid may not ever see those top-of-the-line markers because it all goes into the socialist barrel and is now a community classroom barrel that people just pick out of. They're teaching them 101, and they're saying this is all about being fair,
for people who can't afford it, and blah, 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 blah. Well, if you want to be fair for people that can't afford it, take up a collection or have somebody donate some other stuff. I mean, there's other ways to do this besides teaching them socialism, Marxism, redistribution 101. But that's what they've been doing for the last generation. So we have a whole generation of kids that have gone through this indoctrination. And through this indoctrination, they are being taught this agenda of being good government socialist slaves. Everything is provided for you. Some kids may say, well, my parents couldn't afford to buy me any, but yet it's all provided for me in a socialist way. You know, minority special interest groups are working hard to remove God from our society, our schools, our government, our daily lives. There was a push in New York with the song God Save the USA, where there were kids outside in a they were set up like a choir, you know, they were lined up like a choir singing God Bless the USA, and people were having a fit as they were walking by saying, you can't say God, you can't say God. Well, these are the words of the song. They're saying, no, you can't say that, you can't say that. And they were having arguments, and they were being loud and belligerent. Because these people were saying, God bless the USA. You want to say bless the USA? Then fine, just go ahead and say that. But don't say God. You can't say God. Because these special interest groups are trying to make sure that every aspect of this whole idea comes out of our society. What about our nation, who's waging war on other nations illegally and immorally, killing millions of civilians? All for profit and power, because we know that's what war is about. War is about profit and power. You say, well, that's not what it's about. It's about this, that, that. Well, profit and power are the result. That's what comes from it. And we know how bad the greed is. What about the theft of people's money through this illegal and unconstitutional tax in the form of so-called income tax extraction? What about property taxes, dozens of other illegal taxes, causing poverty for control and greed? And if they can't impose more taxes, they'll just call it a fee. They're doing that all over the place. Now it's no longer, no, we're not raising your taxes, but there is a fee. Oh, what's the fee for? The fee is for the conversation we're having. And then there's a fee for the paperwork I'm about to give you. Then there's a fee for this and a fee for that. But it's not a tax. It's greed. That's what it is. It's control and greed. The existence of the Federal Reserve, a corrupted, non-governmental, private corporation which robs all Americans of their money, hand in hand with the government's approval and contrary to the Constitution. Our society to reject biblical principles on family structures, farming out our kids out to public schools, government propaganda systems, or daycare centers to allow women their right to the workplace, not realizing the incredible value that women provide in creating healthy, stable-minded children in a home environment. Women are incredibly talented at this. Women are incredibly talented at teaching our children the very basic things of life they need to know. Not the things they learn in school, not reading, writing, and arithmetic. Mothers of the world teach our children virtually everything else. They teach them how to be good people, to share. I mean, every other value that there is that's not taught in real public schools are taught by mothers. Our mothers need to be raising our children, not a daycare. And you men, you need to be providing for your family. You go out there and you just vote do-de-o-do all over town with all kinds of different women. You have kids spread out all over the place. Who's supporting them? Not you. No, it's us, the taxpayer. We're supporting your little exploits. We need to come back to our biblical principles. You fathers need to own up for your actions and take care of your families. You know, this list could go on and on, but it's enough to
just present the obvious problems. How can these things be occurring in a family which is of the people, by the people, and for the people? And 80% of those people claim to be followers of Christ. This is a grand lie and self-deceit. And it's leading to God's punishment of this country for rejecting him as a ruler and accepting evil instead. What did God tell us about this evil? Three times under different situations, God told the people this. In Deuteronomy 13:5, so shall you put the evil away from the midst of you. Put the evil away from the midst of you. Deuteronomy 17. So you shall put the evil away from among you. Not only from you personally, but from things around you. Deuteronomy 19. Then shall you do to him as he had thought to have done to his brother. So shall you put the evil away from among you. The Christian movement seems self-deluded. It talks about truth and righteousness, but it's only mostly talk. Where's the well-known Christian groups when it comes to all of the things that we just talked about? Where are they standing? Should they be making it clear that these things are abominations? We've become a nation of cowards, selfish, greedy, liars, and deceivers. We are so far from living as a Christian nation, from 80% of 300 million people, it's not even funny. Well, does all of this sound kind of harsh? Well, you know, the truth of God's word is offensive. It's offensive to people who are not Christian. It's offensive to people that don't have a relationship with Christ. It's offensive to people who are guilty of these things. Because you're telling somebody that what they're doing is wrong. Stop it. Those are the people that are offended. The people who are guilty of these things. 2 Timothy 3:1, but know this, that in the last day perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lover of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people turn away. I talk about 2 Timothy all the time because 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5 and verse 7 are critical to this nation at this moment. Verse 5, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. These are people who claim this spiritual fornication. This is people who have claimed to have a relationship with Christ, but they deny everything about it. They deny everything about him. In verse 7, ever studying but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth, the knowledge of the word. They're never able to understand it or know the truth of what God is trying to tell them. The warnings, the instructions, the consequences of their actions, you know, and not consequences from him. Consequences that come from, you know, he gives us a limited free will. And he gives us the ability to make our own choices. When you make the wrong choice, he also lets you suffer the consequences for your choice. It's your choice. If you make that choice, you're going to suffer the consequences for it, whatever that choice is. You can tell somebody, don't touch that burner on the stove. I know it's red and it's pretty, but it's hot and it'll burn you. They say, oh, but it's so pretty, and they go over and touch it, and they get burned. The consequence of that disobedience is you get burned. You were warned not to do that and what the consequences would be, yet you go and do it anyway. And then you suffer the consequences. You say, why is God not protecting me through this?
Well, hey, stupid. You were warned not to do it, and then you went and did it anyway. The result is you got burned. It has nothing to do with God. It has to do with your own stupidity. The form of godliness. Most of this falls into traditional Christianity, which is a facade, a shadow of truth and righteousness. Where's the light and example that Christ claimed would follow his true followers? Where's the biblical foundation this nation claims to have? Where is that? What used to claim to have? Matthew 7:21 says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.' I never knew you." And who's he saying this to? He's saying this to people who have prophesied in his name, who have cast out demons in his name. These are people who claim to be Christians. Some are going to be preachers, pastors, leaders, big people in the church. There's a lot of people who claim to be Christian who have never actually had started this genuine relationship with Christ. They have never experienced the regeneration that comes with true Christianity. Matthew 25:1 says this: "Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise, 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, 'Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him.' Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'No, lest there should not be enough for us and you. But go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves.' And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he answered and said, 'Assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you.'" Do you see the message here? You have to be ready. There is no second chance. Luke 4:46 says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do the things which I say? Whosoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you whom he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently against the house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. But he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built a house on the earth without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of the house was great." I'm going to do another one. One more here. Genesis 1:1 and Luke 13:30. "And he went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying through Jerusalem. Then one said to him, 'Lord, are there few who are saved?' And he said to them, 'Strive to enter through the narrow gate. For many, I say to you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door, saying, "Lord, Lord, open for us," and he will answer and say to you, "I do not know you. Where are you from?"
Then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence. You taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I do not know you. Where are you from? Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all of the prophets in the kingdom of God and yourself thrust out, they will come from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south and sit down in the kingdom of God. And indeed, there are at last who will be first, and there are first who will be last. See, because Americans have been given their lives to everything but what God has commanded. Our nation's failing daily. We fiddle around and play our games. We allow ourselves to be entertained with mindless distractions, rarely noticing the evil that's around us all of the time. We've been desensitized. We hide the truth because it isn't affecting us immediately. We're selfish. We've let fears and worries dictate our behavior. We accept the lie that I can't do anything about it. We play mind games with ourselves and with others. We deceive ourselves by allowing our time to be eaten up by false leaders, false news media, false sports, and other activities that tell us everything that we want to hear, so that we can avoid those things that challenge us to act as a Christian, to keep his word in spirit and truth, and have this not be just empty talk. People claiming to be Christian, 80%. Give me a break. So, where's the warning that God commands us to be declared to the nation and to the world? Why are so few warned of this pending punishment? It's because nobody wants to offend anyone. They don't want to teach about judgment and wrath. They just want to teach about love. And God is love. And yes, he is love. But he's also a God of judgment and a God of wrath. People refuse to teach that. In fact, before I go on with this, I want to play you a clip about that. So give me just a minute here while I play this clip. Do I have it? Oh, I may not have it. I could have swore I did. All right. Well, it was a good idea, but it was a nice clip. Let me say that. It was a wonderful clip, and you're really missing out not hearing it because I failed to load it up. So let's talk about where does the Bible warn us about this? It's in Hosea 4:6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Hosea 4:6. Look it up for yourself. I'm reading it word for word. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge because you have rejected knowledge. I also will reject you from being priest for me because you have forgotten the law of God. I will also forget your children. The more they are increased, the more they sin against me. I will change their glory into shame. They eat up the sin of my people. They set their heart on the iniquity. And it shall be like people, like priests. So I will punish them for their ways and reward them for their deeds. For they shall eat, but shall not have enough. They shall commit harlotry, but not increase, because they have ceased obeying the Lord. Our leadership has steadily become corrupted. This corruption is picked up by the people. It's the example that's set by our leaders that gradually decays the social and moral standards that God has set for society. This is why no longer is a man's handshake his bond. Now, after you shake someone's hand, you better be washing it. Disinfectant. Put some Purell on there. Because who knows where it's been or what it's been doing. Do you see what I'm saying? There's a direct prophecy for our country. and it's laid out on clear terms. It's a warning to us that if we continue as we are as a nation, our nation will fall. No Christian in word alone will escape this punishment. This is Leviticus 26:14. But if you do not obey me, and do not obey all of my commandments, and if you despise my statutes, or if your soul abhors my judgments, so that you do not perform all of my commandments, but break my covenant, I will also do this to you. I will even appoint terror over you, wasting disease and fever, which shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart. Which means disease will increase as he starts giving you back what you're giving him. You shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. What does that mean? Our harvests are going to international areas, as well as foreigners in our country, illegal aliens eating up our assets. It says, I will set my face against you. You shall be defeated by your enemies. Those who hate you will reign over you. You shall flee when no one pursues you. We're hated today. After all of this, if you do not obey me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. I will break the pride of your power. And let's face it, America's power and pride will be broken by all these things. I'll make your heavens like iron and your teeth like bronze, and your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield its produce, nor shall the trees of the land yield their fruit. Then if you walk contrary to me and are not willing to obey me, I will bring you in seven times more plagues according to your sins. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children, destroy your livestock, and make you few in number. What are those beasts? What are those beasts that will make you few in number? Well, you know, today we have this thing, since we are in the last days and we're coming up very close as these birth pangs increase, we now have Agenda 21. And Agenda 21 is doing this very thing. The goal of these eugenicists are to reduce the population by two-thirds. They're saying there's too many people here, that the earth cannot sustain this many people. They're suggesting that God, if they believed in God, had not created a world sufficient to support the population. He made a mistake. He didn't do a good enough job. That's what they're saying. Well, through Agenda 21, they're going to control not only the population, but they're going to control every other aspect of your life. Every aspect of your life will be controlled through Agenda 21, an international body. America stands in the way of that. America needs to go down before this can be implemented. And Barack Obama, just even in his speech, said the very same thing. You know, I just seen a piece tonight on the news about his illegal immigration agenda. He plans, and he's saying it plainly, he plans on legalizing 11 million illegal aliens and setting up a path for citizenship for anybody else who wants to just pour across our border. Well, you know, not only that, he just signed the Law of the Sea Treaty, which gives revenue from offshore drilling to the United Nations. Now, if you think I'm kidding about this, I'm going to play this short clip. It's about 8 minutes, but it's a clip that explains Agenda 21. This is called Agenda 21 for Dummies. So you don't need to have any prior knowledge of Agenda 21 to understand this. Just know that this is what you're going to hear is laid out in fine detail, very small, fine detail in Agenda 21. This is the goal, and this is what's being implemented. The Law of the Sea is part of that. Also, and as they talk about this, you'll see how all of these things that are explained in this clip about Agenda 21 are things that are happening right now. I'll be right back after this clip.
Sustainable development has become the popularized expression for Agenda 21. Agenda 21 is the 1992 United Nations Rio Declaration on the Environment and Development.
It is the agenda for the 21st century you're living in today, for a brave new world where everything that you cherished and held true will no longer exist.
Agenda 21 defines itself as a comprehensive plan of action to be taken globally, nationally, and locally by organizations of the United Nations systems.
It also elevates nature above man. And it contains something called the precautionary principle, where basically you're guilty until you're proven innocent.
Sustainable development is the philosophy designed to bring human beings across the globe under the full control of a narrow human elite.
It's a 40-chapter document to basically control the world. It's based entirely on socialist control mechanisms.
Sustainable developers have designed a global movement coordinated through a global to local action plan to create world government in accordance with certain objectives. These objectives include an end to national sovereignty, the abolition of private property, the restructure of the family unit, and increasing limitations and restrictions on mobility and individual opportunities.
The Green Goal includes the listings of what's not sustainable. A couple of the examples include private property.
728 lists fossil fuels.
Golf courses and ski lodges are not.
Consumerism.
Irrigation is not sustainable.
Paved roads.
Commercial agriculture.
Herbicides, pesticides. Elsewhere, it lists farmlands, pastures, grazing of livestock.
And the family unit.
The focus of sustainable development is the abolition of private property, societal undermining of the family, and abandonment of the constitutional protection of unalienable rights as described in the Declaration of Independence.
You see, I sat on the Santa Cruz Agenda 21 committees. Now, this was a lot of crazy ideas. This is back in the mid-90s. Crazy ideas, I heard. Mother Earth's surface wasn't to be scratched. Human beings were to be concentrated into human settlement zones. Educational systems were to focus on the environment as the central organizing principle. All aspects of life were covered. Well, I went to these committees at the request of some people who told me that I needed to understand what was going on, and I came back and I said, this is craziness. This is so silly. It has no chance of having any effect on our society. Well, I was wrong.
The United States government's support for sustainable development, Agenda 21, is very clear. In 1992, while the Rio conference was going on, George Bush, then president, was there, where he executed the Agenda 21 protocols on behalf of the United States and brought it back to Washington, D.C. Within a year, Bill Clinton, by executive order, no congressional review, established the President's Council for Sustainable Development. In Santa Cruz, we've got a two-lane freeway system. We need four. But what we're getting is hundreds of millions of dollars of federal money to take a dilapidated rail line that Southern Pacific wants to put in the hands of somebody else so that a commuter line can be built along the railroad track that'll be followed by 14-story buildings where people will live and stack them and pack them units, where developers or so-called sustainable developers will build these high-rises with federal dollars. In fact, Santa Cruz has received a $300 million federal grant to build the first 3,000 of these stack and pack them units. The County Board of Supervisors has said, if you are a sustainable developer, you're immune from any construction defect liability. It's a partnership between selected developers building this new world order and the government using the American taxpayer dollars in order to do it. This is a map of the Wildlands Project. To explain the map, the red are areas that are to be off limits to human beings. No resource development, No human activity. If you live there, you won't. The yellow areas are the areas for major control of all human activity. If you live there, you won't. The black areas, the black dots, are the smart growth zones. That's where human beings are to be stacked and packed in small living units along rail tracks. The smart growth program ultimately has jobs assigned and children cared for by the state.
The question has been asked many times, how the people who are perpetrating these things expect to do this and make it last. And the answer to that is that you steal a generation of children and you indoctrinate them so that they accept these ideas and they become global citizens in the coming global village.
UNESCO came out and declared 2005 to 2015 the decade of education for sustainable development. But they go on to say that it will encompass the 40 chapters of Agenda 21. That is your federal national curriculum. The entire purpose of second grade social studies is to transfer loyalty from the family to the government and teach them about sustainable economic consumption. Students construct their own understandings of reality and realize that objective reality is not knowable. So why bother? The truth, which keeps men free, is being suppressed in order to prop up the attitude training agenda. And it moves on. This is our new math called Connected Mathematics. Standard 3 tells us that students learn that mathematics is man-made, that it is arbitrary, and good solutions are arrived at by consensus. Most of us assume 2 plus 2 is always going to equal 4. You're wrong. We might reach a new consensus. How well does it work? Well, they tell you. In the teacher's guide in the back, it tells us that because the curriculum doesn't emphasize arithmetic computations done by hand, some students may not do as well on tests assessing computational skills. We believe such a trade-off in the favor of CMP is very much to the student's advantage in the world of work. Our children are mathematically illiterate on purpose. How do I know on purpose? Why isn't this just a basic bad idea? Because the Sustainable Development Plan tells us so. Generally, more highly educated people who have higher incomes consume more resources than poorly educated people who tend to have lower incomes. In this case, more education increases the threat to sustainability. Charlotte Iserby, I owe you an apology. I did not believe for the longest time it was a deliberate dumbing down. I thought that dumbing down was a natural consequence of a bad idea. Folks, it's deliberate. It's deliberate.
The sustainable globalist goal is the orchestration of a planned fall of American principles, values, and lifestyles. The effect on the average American will be devastating. With modernizing technology, the ordinary person will live without independence, privacy, or substantive rights.
Another press conference that I attended was the ICLE group, the International Committee for Local Environmental Initiatives. It helps in the implementation of Agenda 21 in all of our local communities. And one of the speakers was Harvey Rubin, who happens to be the vice chair of ICLE. And I asked him about the correlative rights that Americans derive from the United States Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And that, of course, is your individual liberties, your private property, your freedom of speech. I asked about it clashing with Agenda 21. And you know what his response was?
Individual rights must take a back seat to the collective.
All right, so if you're a thinker, and if the obvious stands out to you like it does to me, then you're asking a question right now that says, when he was talking about our education system and the indoctrination of this generation, they say, well, how can that be that they're dumbing people down when they're encouraging everybody to go to college, they're pushing everybody to go to college? Well, the answer to that is twofold.
twofold. One, going to college continues the education of indoctrination. And two, we are in a student loan bubble at the moment that's about to bust because there are so many students out there in so many higher quality educated training for high tech and all of these other high paying jobs that there are no jobs available. They're just not out there. These people are unemployed. They're out of college 2, 3, 4 years. They're having to move back home with their parents. There's no jobs out there. And on top of that, they own these student loans. They owe. They have to make payments on these student loans. These people are never going to get out from under these student loans. It's never going to happen. Unless the government steps in its socialist program and becomes the savior of the problem that they created. Creating another crisis, allowing them to put in more aspects of Agenda 21. Well, Leviticus chapter 23 says this. And if by these things you are not reformed by me, but walk contrary to me, then I also will walk contrary to you. I will punish you yet 7 times for your sins. I will bring a sword against you that will execute the vengeance of the covenant. When you are gathered together within your cities, I will send pestilence among you. You shall be delivered into the hand of your enemy when I have cut off your supply of bread. 10 women shall bake bread in one oven. Then shall bring back your bread by weight, and you shall eat it and not be satisfied. You know, the gist of the things that we're just talking about is to say that God will no longer be supporting this nation because of our national sins. We'll slowly go down. We're suffering more and more because we refuse to obey and do what the instruction manual tells us to do. Our crops will suffer. Our land will suffer. Our people are suffering. Our wealth is being eaten up. Our enemies are conquering us. Eventually, there's going to be a great war that's going to encompass this very nation to the point that many will die, many will be taken prisoners to foreign nations or put in FEMA camps. And these people are allowed to rise up because we have rejected God. If you search, do a Google search on punishment in the Bible and see how serious God is about this. Look at what he's done in the past and don't think he won't do it in the future. These things are being fulfilled today. All you have to do is stop for a second. Take stock in our nation's present plight. Our money is falling in value. Our leaders have become lawless. Our land is being destroyed by chemicals and genetically modified foods. Our food supply is now basically comes from 3 large corporations. The farm is gone. The home farm is gone. Our health is the poorest in the world. With over 50% of our population on medications of some type. Our pharmaceutical industry has taken over our lives. Our schools teach false knowledge and government propaganda and lawlessness. Our families are fractured. Divorce is rampant. The murder of innocent children through abortion is without restraint. Our businesses are corrupted by greed. Our products have become inferior to the rest of the nations in other countries' products. We have allowed corporate greed to destroy millions of American jobs and weaken our infrastructure. America could not gear up for major world conflict because our resources are now in the hands of other nations, some of which are our enemies. Excuse me. Our infrastructure in many places
the same as second and third world nations. We have bad roads, bridges, buildings, hospitals. What is the cost to our nation in rejecting God and biblical values? You don't have to believe in God to see the value in not killing, stealing, lying, cheating on your spouse, honoring your parents, all of that stuff. So what's the cost? Why do so many supposed Christians reject God's words? They have no excuse because they claim to be Christian. What cost is it to the obvious biblical principles for everyone who does not believe in the true God? The cost is they can't do what they want to do. Instead, it's selfishness, vanity, pride, lust. And more importantly, it's submission to something else other than God. Actually, our country is submitting to Agenda 21 and all of its aspects. People are lazy. If this 80% of Christians were actually Christians, we wouldn't be in the situation that we're in. Here's the deal. We either take all of God's word or none of it. We need to do this to determine what's right and wrong, good or evil. It's a natural conflict of interest for everyone. There can be no healthy social order if everyone chooses for themselves what they can or can't do without some sort of guidance or rules, regulations, policies, procedures, and laws. You know, some people believe that child molestation is great stuff, and it's their choice, it's their right. You know, what about the Man-Boy Association? You see, they think this is their choice, and it's their right. Who can rightly stand up and say this is not right? And what do they base their belief on? Some believe that homosexuality is okay, and that God doesn't care who we love in a sexual way. Many people lie in the day. Sin is everywhere in this country. We're not praying for it. And, you know, even more, unless we change direction, change our minds, change our beliefs, change our attitudes, then this country is not going to stand. But who's willing to conform to this kind of standard when it goes against the grain of this selfish, carnal human nature? Who's willing to deny their own desire that damage themselves and everyone and everything around them? America was intended to be a light to other nations. It was to be an example of what a nation could achieve, whose God is the true God of the Bible. It wasn't meant to honor God and his power and plan. I mean, it was meant to, what did I say there? It was meant to honor his power and his plan. We were supposed to be a blessing to other nations. And we were at one time. Now we're a curse to other nations. We've rejected God. And other nations are following our example. You know, America is the light of the world when it comes to Christianity. We have always been the largest representation of the one true God. Now we've taken war and world domination into other countries. We're dishonoring our supposed Christian heritage. Millions have died at our hands of unlawful and unconstitutional actions, laws. Well, this action that we've been taking over the last 100 years will be corrected, with or without our support. This nation and many others will be punished if we neglect the Bible and our relationship with God. Does anyone care anymore? Or are we doomed to this destruction? America is a recipient of the blessings and promises of God. Who can deny that? But they'll be removed. if we don't come back to a biblical foundation in this country. Deuteronomy 30:19. Here's what this says. And I call heaven and earth as witness today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, that you may cling to him, for he is your life and your strength in our days, that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to his fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give to them. Now, this was originally intended for talking to the Jews, but this applies to all of us who belong to him. Romans 10:3, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. There is no righteousness unless it comes from him. The standard we must use is not one of our own choosing. America is showing its sin for the whole world to see. We've got our pants down and everyone's looking. Isaiah 3:9. The look on their countenance witnessed against them. They declare their sins as Sodom. They do not hide it. Woe to their soul, for they have brought evil upon themselves. Sin is displayed throughout our republic. People revealing every kind of destructive behavior, which simply trains our kids to follow suit. What hope is there for any nation that's so bent? What does history tell us of this kind of behavior and the end result? The nations in the past have fallen. We have to reawaken our desire for truth and to be a better people, to rise above the level of animal nature. Remember the example of the dog? We have to rise above that. We have to rise above being animals. Matthew 5:6 said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. But we don't hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. We try to create our own, thinking it's better than what God has. How many people today in this country really hunger and thirst for righteousness? Where are they looking for this righteousness, and how are they practicing it? Matthew 5:20 says, "Write to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter into the kingdom of heaven." You people who are Christian in name only, you have no salvation to look forward to. You didn't lose it. You never had it in the first place. Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. We need to rethink our collective and individual paths, move back toward the true God before it's too late. Before it's too late. Now, for all of you who any of this applies to, I'm going to play this short clip for you. Listen and try to understand what I'm saying in this clip. What is sin? The wickedness of mankind in the mind and body. The deliberate act of evil to the known will of God. It's the undying corruption within God's world, and upon death follows a lost eternity. But there was a man, born as a human with the power of God, who changed all things. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. He came as a child into the world and dwelt among us as our own. He was the light of the world. sent to bring mankind out of darkness and lead them on the path of truth. To free each and every one of us from sin and the darkness within us since we were created. As a child, he taught in the temples with authority and power, and people were filled with hope. His teaching was love, and through his power, he received any who believed in him and made them children of God. For he was God's only Son, sent into the world that all might believe. He's the Savior of the world, who made all things new, and whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. Through love, he gave his life and died for all mankind, taking all of our sins upon himself so we could be free. Death couldn't overcome him. He rose from the dead and ascended into the far reaches of heaven. There he waits in his Father's kingdom. His name is Jesus, the Savior of the world. He came to earth once, he will come again. Eyes have not seen, nor ears heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those that love him. He lives, and his love lasts forever. He is the Son of God, and all things were created for him. To the glory of the Father, who is with us always. Well, you know, that thing moves me, even though I'm the one who recorded it. It still moves me to hear that thing. We don't have a lot of time left, but I want to ask a rhetorical question, because we're going to talk about this. Can a true Christian commit this kind of apostasy? You know, for everyone who's once been enlightened, they've tasted of the highly gifts, the heavenly gifts. These people who have been partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and in the powers of the age to come that have fallen away, is it possible to renew them again to repentance? Since they again crucify themselves to God. Well, that's a passage from Hebrews 6:4. And this passage raises a lot of important questions. Is it possible for a true Christian to fall away from the faith and not only become apostate, but irredeemable? And if so, I'm not saying it is the Bible doctrine of the perseverance of the saints proven false? And if not, is this warning meaningless? What sin does the author of this have in mind that is so hideous that it precludes further repentance for forgiveness? You know, apostasy is not new. Some have suggested that you could lose your salvation. Our salvation is by faith and grace. The only sin that God will not forgive is to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. Now, apostasy, when it comes to who and what we are, some have assumed that enlightened refers to baptism. Again, man steps in and tries to interpret what God has said. This is not a book of confusion. You know, it most likely refers to the light that of Christ that drove out the darkness in the Gospels. What's significant is not simple instruction for salvation, but the renewal of the mind and of life, the tasting the heavenly gift. As we've seen, this means that they've experienced it, the gift from heaven, redemption in Christ through the gospel, being made partakers of the Holy Spirit. It involves sharing with the redeemed community and the Holy Spirit. Albert Barnes once said, "This is not a language which can properly be applied to anyone but a true Christian." And through it, it's true that an unpardoned sinner may be enlightened and awakened by the Holy Spirit. Yet the language here used in that passage in Hebrews would be more likely to be employed to describe his state. That is, the last of four principles that's talked about in the Messianic Age. The powers of the age to come. They're already present in the redeemed community who look forward to their fulfillment of God's word. That is his guarantee that through faith and grace, we're going to heaven. He does his part. He provides the grace. We do our part. We provide the faith. It's not by works that any man can boast. So let's make sure that we understand that. Your works, good or bad, are not what gets you into heaven. Now, your works are the fruit of the Spirit. If you are truly transformed, then what comes out of you is good fruits. In other words, you have a desire through this redemption to listen to God's voice, because God has revealed himself to you. When he fills you with the Holy Spirit, he's revealed himself to you. You now have the Holy Spirit inside you. You have a special relationship with God that other people don't have. As a Christian, you have this special relationship. And you have this desire. It's not a point of him saying, do this, and you reluctantly go do it, even though we do reluctantly have to do some of these things. But you have the desire to do it. That's when you know that you've been transformed, that you've been regenerated. Without this regeneration, my friend, you're not a Christian. If you are not regenerated, if you don't see the world in a whole new light, if the cross has not turned your life upside down, you have not been regenerated, and you are not a Christian. Now, you may think you are. You can say you are. You can read all books from every Christian writer out there, and you can jump up and down to a jig. You can do whatever you want. But if you don't have this regeneration, if the sacrifice on the cross, the shedding of blood, and the resurrection on the third day has not completely turned your life upside down, nothing else matters. You're not a Christian. That's the bottom line. Without this regeneration, you're not a Christian. Face it, if you haven't had this, you're not a Christian. All right, well, how did I do tonight? Did I offend many people? I'm sure I did. I'm sure my email box is going to be full probably within the hour, because God's word is offensive to a lot of people. Sometimes to spit out the truth and to say it without reservation offends people. And I'm sure that I have been successful in doing that tonight. Well, you know, think about the things we talked about. Let me apologize again to everyone who keeps trying to call in. I see the switchboard keeps, the calls come in and then they drop off. They come in and drop off. And, you know, usually it stays pretty consistent. But we're having problems with our phone lines. I hope you folks are not getting knocked off and having to recall and getting just little bits and pieces of the program. But thank you to everyone who's listening through the Blog Talk Radio Network, for all you folks on Spreaker and iTunes and the social networks, everyone listening through our regular broadcast affiliates, for those of you who are going to carry this program. I may be on it like 3 o'clock in the morning in some of these places, but this program might be a little much, and I understand if you don't want to run it. But this is something that had to be said. These are things that had to be said. So as we conclude the program, let me tell you this. The email is contact@wdeanshook.com. Feel free to email me and spill your guts. Come to the webpage. I just updated some parts of it today, wdeanshook.com. You can also join me on Facebook, Twitter. And I want to go out with one of my favorite songs from our friend Georgia Red, who asked a critical question in a wonderful song that he has done called Do You Know Him? Now, before you exit this program, listen to this song, listen to what he says, and I'll see you on our next program. God bless you all, and thank you.
That has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's a centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's the loftiest idea of literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's a fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient Savior. And I wonder, do you know him? You know, I wish I could describe him to you. But he's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't get him out of your mind. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave could not hold him. Ha ha! Yes, that's my king. And I wonder, do you know him?